Hello everyone. Let me show you something cool. This is an experiment you can probably do at home. All you will need is a wooden spoon and a body of water. Now, let's see what happens when I move this wooden spoon through the body of water. So you're probably wondering, what's so cool about this video? If you looked carefully, you would have observed two dark spots emanating from the edge of the spoon. What are these dark spots? These are called vortices, and we see them all around us. So much so that the flight of birds would not be possible without them. Did you also know that the airline industry loses millions of dollars because of these vortices? Vortices are inevitable in our world, where sometimes they are useful and sometimes not so much. In this episode, we find out more about them.
Hi, I'm Nikhilesh.
And I'm Kushal. We're the two broke scientists.
So, what is a vortex? We actually covered a bit about the basics behind a vortex in a previous video. You can check it out here. But just to recap, in fluid mechanics, a vortex is usually defined if you have a bunch of particles that are rotating about a common center. Now, vortices have a couple of very interesting properties. The first one is that the center, which is also called the core of the vortex, is usually a region of low pressure, which means that it attracts particles from all around it. The second property is that each vortex has a unique direction of rotation. And because of this rotation, it sets the particles all around it revolving around the same direction as well. Now, these two basic properties have some important consequences for the flight of birds and planes, as we'll see in this video.
Let's talk about aeroplanes. As you probably already know, to produce lift, wings have a region of low pressure on the top and a region of high pressure at the bottom. At the ends of the wings, this high pressure air tends to leak out, which leads to a formation of the wingtip vortices. Now remember the properties of these vortices? These vortices cause the air at the tip of the wings to deflect downwards. This essentially makes the wing operate at a lower angle of attack, which causes a drop in lift. Aeroplanes try to counter these wingtip vortices by using devices called as winglets. You've probably seen them before. In fact, these winglets are so important that United Airlines estimates that they save about $200 million just because of the winglets. These winglets reduce the strength of the wingtip vortices by reducing the leakage of pressure around the wingtips.
So, we've established that vortices are clearly bad for aeroplanes, right? And planes use wingtips or winglets to try to mitigate the negative consequences of these vortices. But did the idea of winglets come from birds? Because if you think about it, hasn't man's pursuit of flight always been inspired by the flight of birds? Are vortices equally bad for birds as they are for planes? Before we look at how vortices actually affect birds, it's important to recognize that the flight of birds is actually very different from the flight of planes. I mean, aside from the obvious flapping, bird flight is actually pretty complex, and it involves a combination of aerodynamics, kinematics, biology, and whatnot, and is actually still a very widely investigated topic. Now, bird flight also has different regimes. You have gliding flight, flapping flight, and bounding flight, and the physics involved in all three are vastly different.
In gliding flight, the principles of aerodynamics are similar. And here, wingtip vortices are detrimental to the lift generated by birds. In fact, certain species of birds use their feathers as wingtips in gliding flight. Now, the physics of flapping flight, though, are very different. Birds don't have engines like aeroplanes, which give them thrust to move in the forward direction. So the main source of thrust for birds are their wings. But also remember that the same wings should produce lift. And this is where things get really interesting.
To lift off from the ground, different birds use different mechanisms. Two common ones though are the bird pushing off with their legs and also flapping their wings. Now, when a bird flaps its wings, there are two main strokes. You have the downstroke. And the upstroke. And if you look at the wing closely, you see that it moves more along an arc rather than a straight line. But to simplify things, let's just assume that the wing is a flat plate and it's moving straight through the fluid.
Now the plate moving against the fluid experiences a force from the fluid. By applying Newton's second law, we can tell that the force on the plate is proportional to the mass of the fluid it moves times the velocity of the plate. If we now move more mass, the force generated would be more. But in reality, something really interesting happens.
Because of the properties of fluids, not all the fluid that is directly under the plate is moved by it when it goes down. In fact, most of the fluid moves around the edge of the plate and goes behind it. You can actually see this very clearly when the plate is moving very slowly. Because of this, if the plate is moving pretty slowly, the force developed by it is very small. Probably not even enough to produce lift for birds. But now, because of another interesting property of fluids called viscosity, if you increase the speed of movement of the plate, the fluids that's supposed to just turn around the edge and flow around the plate is now separated from the edge and forms two pairs of vortices, or rather a pair of vortices around the edge of the plate. And that's exactly what you saw in the beginning of the video, where you had the kind of ladle that's moving through water and you see the vortices that are forming around the edge.
So the fluid around the vortex moves towards the vortices and along the direction of rotation. So essentially, even though most of the fluid moves around the plate, a lot of it gets sucked back in the direction of motion of the plate. So if you apply Newton's second law again, the vortices contribute to the momentum of the fluid in the direction of the plate, which causes a force in the opposite direction.
Now you might be wondering that if a bird produces lift during its downstroke, doesn't it produce the opposite or kind of a downforce during the upstroke? Well, actually, the kinematics of the wing movement are very different between the downstroke and the upstroke. There are a couple of key differences though. The first is that during the downstroke, the feathers of a bird are fully closed. But during the upstroke, the feathers open up, which means it allows fluid to pass through the feathers, kind of mitigating the vortex formations. The second key difference is that during the downstroke, the wing is fully stretched out. But during the upstroke, the bird retracts its wings and moves up. You can actually see this very clearly in the slow motion video taken by Smarter Every Day.
So you see, a vortex is not necessarily a bad thing. A vortex might be bad for an aeroplane, but it is very essential for the flight of birds. What we've covered in this video is just the tip of the iceberg. Currently, a lot of studies are being performed to understand the flight of birds and insects on this planet.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed it and also learned about why vortices can be both good and bad. Stay safe, be at home, maintain social distancing, be responsible. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Bye.